In this module, we shall understand the assumptions of OLS under the simple regression analysis. Let us first understand the meaning of regression analysis. Regression analysis is concerned with the study of the dependence of one variable, the dependent variable, on one or more other variables, the explanatory variables, with a view to estimating and/or predicting the population mean or average value of the former in terms of the known or fixed in repeated sampling values of the latter. The main question is to estimate the population regression function, which is also called the PRF, on the basis of the sample regression function, which is called the SRF. Since in practice we have a sample from a given population, although there are several methods of obtaining the SRF as an estimator of the true PRF, in regression analysis, the method that is used most frequently is that of ordinary least square or OLS. This method states that the estimators should be chosen in such a way that the residual sum of squares is as small as possible. A simple regression model is used to study the relationship between two variables. It is a regression model where the dependent variable is continuous, explained by a single exogenous variable, and linear in the parameters. It is also called two-variable linear regression model or bivariate linear regression model because it relates two variables x and y. Y is called the dependent variable or the regressant, and x is called the independent variable or explanatory variable or the regressor. The term U, called the error term or the disturbance in the relationship, represents factors other than X that affects Y. A simple regression analysis effectively treats all factors other than X that affects Y unobserved. After studying this module, you shall be able to outline the assumptions on which the classical normal linear model is based and to understand the significance of these assumptions. You must be familiar with the classical normal linear regression model. The primary objective in regression analysis is to estimate the population regression function, henceforth known as PRF. Yi is equal to A plus Bxi plus Ui. On the basis of SRF, Yi hat is equal to A hat plus B hat Xi plus U hat I. The basic idea of the regression model is to estimate the population parameters A and B from a given sample. These regression estimates will be further used for estimation, hypothesis testing, as well as the problem of prediction. For that purpose, there is a need to make several assumptions about the manner in which Yi is generated. This is important because PRF shows that Yi depends on both Xi and Ui. Therefore, unless we are specific about how Xi and Ui are created or generated, there is no way we can make any statistical inference about the Yi and A and B. Thus, to have a valid interpretation of the regression estimates, the assumptions made about the Xi variables and the error term is extremely critical. Before we can use our model, we need to understand the assumptions we imposed on it to construct it. Recall that we have made simplifying assumptions so that we can convert the scatter of points into something that is of use to us. If these assumptions are invalid, they will affect the meaning of our results. The relationship between the regressant and the regressor and the random disturbance is linear in the parameters. Yi is equal to A plus Bxi plus Ui. The regressant Y and the regressor X themselves may be non-linear. Thus, the term linear regression always means a regression that is linear in parameters. The betas, that is the parameters, are raised to the first power only. It may or may not be linear in the explanatory variables, the X's. The next assumption is that the values of X are fixed in repeated sampling. More technically, X is assumed to be non-stochastic. The regressor X is distributed independently of the random disturbance.
According to this assumption, each observation of the regressor takes the same value for different samples of the regressant. This is a strong assumption in the case of the social sciences, where in general it is not possible to experiment. Data are obtained by observation, not by experimentation. It is important to remark that the results obtained using this assumption would remain virtually identical if we assume the regressors are stochastic, provided the additional assumption of independence between the regressors and the random disturbance is fulfilled. Further, we have the next assumption as each value of xi and of y is observed without measurement error. This assumption may be partially relaxed to state that the regressor xi does not contain measurement errors. This is an assumption that is not often fulfilled in practice, since the measurement instruments are unreliable in the economy. Think, for example, of the multitude of errors that can be made in the collection of information through surveys on families. The sample variance of x is different from zero and has a finite limit as n tends to infinity. Next, the assumption on the parameter is that the parameters a and b are fixed. If this assumption were not adopted, the regression model would be very difficult to handle. In any case, it may be acceptable to postulate that the model parameters are stable over time, if it is not a very long period, or space, if it is relatively limited. We shall now look at the assumptions on the random disturbances. The disturbances have zero mean. E ui is equal to 0, where I is equal to 1, 2, 3 to n. The mean or expected value of the random disturbance term ui is 0 for a given value of x. In other words, the conditional mean value of ui is 0. Symbolically, we have e ui over xi equal to 0. Thus, the average value or the mean value of the deviation between the mean and actual value of yi corresponding to any given xi should be 0. This assumption thus states that the factors not explicitly included in the model and therefore subsumed in ui do not systematically affect the mean value of y, so that the positive ui values cancel out the negative ui values, so that the average or mean effect on y is zero. This implies strict exogeneity. The immediate consequence of the exogeneity assumption is that the regressors are uncorrelated with the errors. The assumptions of exogeneity is very critical for the OLS theory. If the assumption holds, then the regressor variables are called exogenous. If it does not hold, then those regressors that are correlated with the error term are called endogenous. And then the OLS estimates become invalid. This is not a restrictive assumption. Let us suppose, for example, that E ui is equal to 5. We could then redefine the model in the following way. Yi is equal to a plus 5 plus bxi plus v, where v is equal to u minus 5. Moving on to the next assumption. The disturbances have a constant variance. This assumption is called the homoscedasticity assumption. The word has its origin from the Greek homo equal and scedasticity, which is called spread. This means that the variation of y around the regression line is the same across the x values. That is to say, it neither increases or decreases as x varies. The figure shows the case of homoscedasticity, where the variance of the disturbance term is constant across all the values of x. This diagram shows the case of heteroscedasticity, where the variance is not constant. The variance varies with different x, as can be seen in the figure. Given the value of x, the variance of ui is the same for all observation. That is, the conditional variance of ui are identical. Symbolically, we have v ui by xi is equal to e ui minus e ui divided by xi the whole square, which is equal to e ui divided by xi square. Because e ui divided by xi is equal to 0, this is equal to sigma square, where v stands for variance. The residuals thus have constant variance, homogeneous variance. that is VUI by XI is equal to sigma square. The equation states that the variance of UI for each XI, that is the conditional variance of UI, is some positive constant number equal to sigma square, which implies the assumption of homoscedasticity or equal variance. Stated differently, the equation means that the Y population corresponds to various X values have the same variance. Put simply, the variation round the regression line, which is the line of average relationship between X and Y, is the same across the X value. It neither increases or decreases as X varies. In contrast, if the conditional variance of Y population varies with X, then this situation is known as heteroscedasticity or unequal spread. Symbolically, this situation is represented as VUI divided by XI is equal to sigma I square, where the subscript indicates the variance of the Y population that is no longer constant. The next assumption we have is of no autocorrelation. The disturbances with different subscripts are not correlated with each other. That is, the disturbances corresponding to different individuals or different periods are not correlated with each other. Given any two values of x, xi and xj where I is not equal to j, the correlation that exists between any two ui and uj where I is not equal to j is zero. Symbolically, covariance of ui uj divided by xi xj is equal to e curly bracket open, box bracket open, ui minus eui, box bracket shut, divided by xi, curly bracket shut, into uj minus euj, all this over xj, bracket shut, which is equal to eui divided by xi into uj divided by xj, which is equal to 0. Where I and J are two different observations and where COV means covariance. Thus, we can say that the values of U are serially independent and their covariance is accordingly zero. This means that given XI, the deviations of any two Y values from their mean value do not exhibit any particular pattern. If the deviations or the disturbances follow systematic patterns, then they exist autocorrelation. Further, we have the next assumption as the disturbance U is normally distributed. That is, U tends to move towards N bracket open 0 sigma squared bracket shut. The reason for this assumption is that if U is normally distributed, so will Y and the estimated regression coefficients. And this will be useful in performing tests of hypothesis and constructing confidence intervals for A and B. Here, UI is normally distributed with mean equal to 0 and variance sigma squared, and covariance UI UJ is equal to 0 where I is not equal to J. We know that for two normally distributed variables, zero covariance or correlation means independence of the two variables. Thus, with the normality assumption, UI and UJ are not only uncorrelated but are also independently distributed. The justification for the assumption depends on the central limit theorem, the CLT. In essence, this theorem states that if a random variable is the composite result of the effects of an indefinite number of variables, it will have an approximately normal distribution even if its components do not, provided that none of them is dominant. In other words, if there are a large number of independent and identically distributed random variables, then with a few exceptions, the distribution of their sum tends to a normal distribution as the number of such variables increase indefinitely. Hence, CLT provides a theoretical justification for the assumption of normality of UI. Let us derive the assumption of zero covariance mathematically. Zero covariance between ui and xi or e ui xi is equal to 0. Covariance of ui xi is equal to e ui minus e bracket ui bracket closed into xi minus e xi the whole bracket shut. which is equal to E bracket open UI small simple bracket open XI minus EXI one bracket shut the second and then the box bracket. Since EUI is equal to 0, EUI XI minus EXI EUI, since EXI is non-stochastic, which is equal to EUI XI since EUI is equal to 0, which is equal to 0 by assumption. This assumption states that the disturbance U and explanatory variable X are uncorrelated. But if X and U are correlated, it is not possible to assess the individual effects on Y. Thus, if X and U are positively correlated, X increases when U increases and it decreases when U decreases. Similarly, if X and U are negatively correlated, X increases when U decreases and it decreases when U increases. In either case, it is difficult to isolate the influence of X and U on Y. Moving on to the meaning of BLUE or blue. The discussed mentioned conditions are the sufficient conditions for the least square estimator to possess desirable properties. In particular, these assumptions imply that the parameter estimates will be unbiased, consistent, and efficient in the class of linear unbiased estimators. If we meet these assumptions, then our estimators A and B are best linear unbiased estimators, that is BLUE or blue. That is, they have a minimum variance in the entire class of unbiased estimators. And estimators say the OLS estimator B is said to be a best linear unbiased estimator or blue of the population parameter if the following hold. One, it is linear, that is linear function of a random variable such as the dependent variable Y in the regression model. Two, it is unbiased, that is its average or expected value is equal to the true value. Third, it has a minimum variance in the class of all such linear unbiased estimators. An unbiased estimator with the least variance is known as an efficient estimator. This is the gist of the famous Gauss-Markov theorem, which states that given the assumptions of the classical linear regression model, the least square estimators in the class of unbiased linear estimators have a minimum variance. That is, they are blue, which is BLUE. A very important note to make is that the actual data rarely satisfies the assumption. That is, the method is used even though the assumptions are not true. Variation from the assumptions can sometimes be used as a measure of how far the model is from being useful. Many of these assumptions may be relaxed in more advanced treatments. Reports of statistical analysis usually include analysis of tests on the sampling data and methodology for the fit and the usefulness of the model.
Let us now summarize what we have learned in this module. The basic framework of regression analysis is the CLRM. And the CLRM is based on a certain set of assumptions. These assumptions are, one, the relationship between the regressant and the regressor, and the random disturbance is linear in the parameters. However, the regressant Y and the regressor X themselves may be non-linear. The values of X are fixed in repeated sampling, or X is assumed to be non-stochastic. Each value of XI and of Y is observed without measurement error. The sample variance of X is different from O and has a finite limit as n tends to infinity. The parameters A and B are fixed. The disturbances have zero mean. Homoscedasticity or the disturbances have a constant variance. No autocorrelation, or we can say that the values of U are serially independent and their covariance is accordingly zero. The disturbance U is normally distributed, that is n has 0 sigma squared. 0 covariance between UI and XI or expected value of ui xi is equal to 0. Based on these assumptions, the least square estimators take on certain properties summarized in the Gauss-Markov theorem, which states that in the case of linear unbiased estimator, the least square estimators have minimum variance. In short, they are BLUE or blue. The CLRM is a theoretical construct or abstraction because it is based on a set of assumptions that may be stringent or unrealistic. However, such abstraction is often necessary in the initial stages of studying any field of knowledge. If any of these assumptions is violated, that is, if there is non-linearity, serial correlation, heteroscedasticity, and or non-normality, then the forecast, confidence intervals, and economic insights yielded by a regression model may be at best inefficient or at worst seriously biased or misleading. Once the CLRM is mastered, one can find out what happens if one or more of its assumptions are not satisfied.